Welcome back to the Mighty Thor story, the Jane Foster Thor story. Now, this has been an incredible ride, but it is coming to its inevitable conclusion, which means it's time for us to catch you up so we can get to the death of Thor. Now, for those of you who are just joining us for the first time and are curious as to why Thor is a woman in this series, let me give you a quick recap. Back in Original Sin, Thor, as you know him, Odin's son, was deemed unworthy of the hammer. Jane Foster then found the hammer and took it, but she's currently dying of cancer. Whenever she activates her powers of Thor, it wipes out all of the chemotherapy, healing her, but when she puts the hammer back down, she's now a woman suffering with cancer. And to prove that mortals are strong enough to withstand anything that comes their way, basically she's refusing to take Asgardian healing mechanisms to get rid of it. I think that's the best way to word that. The story has now gone on to where people are fighting against the fact that there is a new Thor, fighting against her because she has the hammer, and the All-Mother, the original Thor's mother, is fighting against Odin. It's a long storyline, but basically it's building up to a giant war, and in this episode, we're going to see the War of the Shi'ar, and Loki and Meliketh are still trying to manipulate things behind the scenes. I know this was one hell of an opening, guys. Thanks for sticking it out. Enjoy the video. The gods of Asgard have many enemies, as gods often do. But even the boldest of them know better than to attack the Golden City, for those walls are guarded by the all-seeing eye of Heimdall. It is said that he could see a single maggot in a field of freshly fallen snow 1,000 worlds away. Even though he can see things galaxies away, he must blink. And if one were simply fast enough to cross that vast space in a blink of an eye, well, as Heimdall would say, no. Suddenly, a powerful force shoots across the skies into Heimdall, and a voice tells him to stand down. His fight is not with him. As Heimdall stands back up, he tells the being that he knows him. He's observed his exploits from across the spaceways. It was thought that he was supposed to be one of honor. And Gladiator floats back down, telling him that he has been called many things, but today he is the Magister of the Shi'ar, and currently on a mission from its gods. While Heimdall battles with the Gladiator, there is another pounding sound, but coming from Jane Foster's door in the residential halls of Asgardia. Jane opens the door to see Cole, and as she thinks that this should be good, she asks him what she can do for him today. Cole says that even though she is supposed to be representing her beloved little mudball, she has been absent from the Congress of Worlds 9 days this month. He has come here to inform her that as of now, she currently has 2 options regarding her stay here. Either rid herself of this pesky cancer, or forfeit her seat in the Congress. If she is to fail to do either of these, or if she finally has the decency to spare them of her pathetic suffering and die, a replacement will come to take her place. As Cole leaves, Jane shouts that this isn't over, the Congress won't stand for! But before she can finish, he cuts her off, telling her that she overestimates the number of friends that she has there. At that moment, a guard runs up to Cole, telling him that they just received word that there has been a disturbance at the Bifrost. Asgardia is under attack. Jane goes back to her room, looking at Mjolnir, stating that she knows that it's killing her. But she's glad to see it, because she suddenly feels like hitting something really, really hard. Back at the front gates, Cole runs in shouting for Heimdall to report what has just happened. What sort of enemy would dare to try and face the immovable Heimdall? Heimdall pushes a rock that was on top of him, stating, "The unstoppable kind." Everyone looks up to see Gladiator standing there, and just as they spot him, he radios back to go ahead and open up the Stargate. Pink lights begin to shine as beings start to appear, and Cole calls out to all of the Thunder Guards to ready themselves. They are being invaded! Gladiator tells them, "No, you are being conquered!" Within only a few moments, Gladiator's forces begin to swarm around Asgardia, laying waste to everything in sight. The warriors of Asgard fight, but their combined strength is no match for the Gladiator's invasion. Cole manages to land a blow on Gladiator's son, Kubark, resulting in Gladiator turning his entire focus on him. But before Gladiator can save his son, a giant bolt of lightning strikes and Jane floats there, telling them, "Whatever this is, it is just now ended." Gladiator looks at her, telling her that she is correct, and then radios back to ready the neuro cell. As Kubark is taken away, Gladiator then turns his attacks to Jane Foster Thor, easily knocking her through the buildings. Thor tries to fight back, but just like the others, her strength is nowhere close to the Gladiator's. He picks her up from the rubble, radioing back to the power of the teleporters to engage now, and the same pink light surrounds the two of them, and they vanish. And a short while later, Jane begins to open up her eyes, asking, "Where are they?" Before her is Gladiator kneeling, telling her that this place is Mukron Palace. Now kneel. Kneel before the gods of the Shi'ar and pray for mercy. She looks right at the two glowing white gods and says that if they were looking for someone to kneel, they have abducted the wrong god. The husband, Kathari, says no. They do believe that they have the right god. And his wife, Shara, tells Jane that her arrogance and discouteness confirms it. Kathari then says that they are Shara and Kathari, the Star Mother and the Father of Light, creators of all space and time, supreme deities for the one true cosmic chosen people. They breathe nebula to lie, weep comets, and speak with the voice of a quadrillion supernovas. And today they will teach her what it truly means to be a god. Jane walks up the steps asking what do they wish to teach her. Just 3 days ago, she was holding a mortal woman as she died of cancer that ravaged her brain, and all she could do was pray. There are so many gods spread across the cosmos, ones who boast about their own majesty and almightiness. Yet, where is that woman now? What heaven does she reside in? She resides in none of them because no god bothered to listen or care. Now, the only thing that she wishes to know now is why is she even here? She has done nothing to the Shi'ar yet. Shara begins to say that they wish to challenge her to a, but before she can finish, Jane walks off telling them, "My answer is no. Now, if you'll excuse me, and even if you don't." Gladiator says that she may want to listen. Currently, they have 3 Shi'ar super destroyers aimed at the Earth's orbit, heavily cloaked and fully armed. If she does not answer this challenge, they have orders to obliterate the entire planet. He is sorry to say, but he is honor-bound too. And in a flash, Kathari rushes forward, grabbing Gladiator by the throat, slamming him to the ground, asking, "You care to apologize to her?" As the two deities begin to beat on the gladiator, Jane begins to conjure up her lightning, telling them, "This ends now, or I will end you." The lightning bends around them, and Shara walks up, punching through it and into Jane. And as Jane starts to get back up, an alien walks up, stating that he is afraid that he is going to have to insist that they follow proper protocol here. The alien then introduces himself as Shadrach, and says that the trial of combat isn't scheduled until round 17. He is here from the omnipotent city to officiate this challenge of the gods. So shall they go ahead and get started? Later, high above the Shi'ar throne world of Shandalar, the first challenge is set to begin. Kathari says that on this world, they are revered and worshipped by 18 billion souls who call this planet home. Here, they will show the true power that a god can wield. Shara shouts that that is enough talk. Now they battle as gods do, with the challenge of natural disasters. Jane takes a moment to think about it, and as she starts to understand, she watches a giant tidal wave form on the planet's coast. The citizens below all begin to run and scream, asking for Shara and Kathari to save them. And Jane asks, "Why would you do this?" Kathari tells her that because even after thousands, maybe millions, die for no discernible reason whatsoever, they will still flock to their shrines to worship us. But as the two gods continue to praise themselves, Jane takes it upon herself to try and save everyone. Before the wave can come crashing down, she creates a whirlwind, sucking the water up and placing it into a seat. Shara shouts, "That is not how you play this game!" And Kathari says that she has forfeited. They have won! They have proven that they are the superior gods! Shatrax says, "Actually, I wouldn't be so sure about that. The people below are all praising Thor now." Meanwhile, at the edge of the Shi'ar-controlled space, the patrol ships begin to pick up something. Their ships are suddenly attacked, and the commander asks what hit them. Are they being attacked by weapons that can pierce shields? And the operator says, "Actually, it would appear it's something called arrows." And Cull shouts to the archers to ready another volley. For the rest, prepare to board their ships. Back with the trials, though, Shara and Kathari continue to display their power, showing how even if they destroy their own followers, they will still be loved. And each time they attempt to kill the civilians, Jane is there to stop them, shouting that she doesn't care if she has to forfeit the wrong, just end this madness. After one last trial, one where Jane couldn't save the people, she flies up, begging that they stop the plagues, the floods, the brimstone, all of it. Let them finish this with a trial of combat. And Shara laughs, telling her that she truly wishes the honor of facing them, then she must first survive the challenge of ultimate judgment. Jane shouts that if that means that she can end this farce, then I, she... Shadrach then stops her, whispering that she doesn't understand. They cannot unleash the ultimate judgment. She wouldn't survive. None of them would. A being then appears before Shara and Kathari. As Jane begins to wonder how she came into this position, we see a few days ago, we see how this thing happened. A being appeared before Shara and Kathari, telling them, "Not a single god respects you or fears you. Dare I say, most of them don't even know you exist. But there is one who is prayed to." And Loki smiles as he tells them, "Thor, everywhere they pray to Thor. Trust me, for Loki knows." As Loki turns to leave, he tells Meliketh that he knows that he's listening. This was easier than they imagined, so go ahead and open up the Black Bifrost and bring him to Jotunheim. Back in the current times, Ashara and Kathari watch as Thor tries to protect everyone. They laugh, telling her that her score will never catch up to theirs. When suddenly Mjolnir shoots into the chamber, cracking them both in the head, and Jane walks up telling them that there will be no more challenges. With a hammer in hand, she slams it to the ground, splitting it, telling them that she knows not why they hate her, and at this point she no longer cares. They want a challenge, then fine, she challenges them to stop her from beating them senselessly. But before Jane can make her way up the broken stairs, Kathari blasts her away, stating that it is over, they have won. Shara then turns to Shadrach, telling them to do it, unleash the ultimate judgment. Shadrach clutches his pendant, quietly asking why couldn't Gore have killed them instead of his friends, and the pendant responds that this is Omnipotent City. Priority request received. Jane gets back up shouting that she is done with mercy and now she only speaks with thunder. Shara tells her that thunder will not be enough, and as Jane bashes Shara in the face, she tells her that it is a good thing that she brought Ura then. At the same moment, Gladiator and Kabark are knocked through the walls into the hall, and Kabark says that he can't feel anything, especially his face. Seconds later, Cole crashes in on a longboat, shouting to Shara and Kathari, prepare to make peace with your fears. Jane looks up asking why is he here, and Cole tells her saving her life by the looks of it. She then asks why, and Cole says because no one but me can pry that hammer from your cold dead hand. Lightning begins to swirl around the hammer, and Jane says that there is no one who is going to be prying it from her just yet. At least, not until she has rammed it down the Shi'ar's throats a few hundred times. Cole laughs, telling her that now she is finally talking like an Asgardian. And Kathari tells them, look, you've brought friends. Maybe now this challenge of the gods will actually be challenging. Meanwhile, on a nameless world, somewhere in the darkest corners of the cosmos, a raging fire burns, and from its pits, a hand reaches up, clawing its way out. Down on Earth, a young boy sits on a small island, stating how it may come as a shock, but the people of this planet are unmitigated idiots. The island begins to rumble, and Quentin, the Omega-level telepath, tells the sentient island Krakoa that he knows what he is thinking, literally. This place is just boring. Suddenly, a magical portal opens up and Jane and Kubark step out. Kubark tells Quentin that the universe needs his help, and yes, he's just as surprised by that as he is. Quentin hardly acknowledges them, telling them, right, sounds fun. Now get off my island. Jane asks, this is the savior that you spoke of? We're wasting our time here. Quentin gets up telling the group that he would love to help them with whatever, but he doesn't. So if they could leave, he'll talk to himself in peace. Jane says they can no longer carry on. They should be back stopping the Phoenix from destroying the... But before she could finish, Quentin says, Wait. Did you say the Phoenix? Just hours before that, the battle between the Asgardians and the Shi'ar had begun. As they fought, Shadrach stopped everyone, stating that they must not fight. A challenge has been made, and that challenge has a victor. The winner is Thor. Everyone in the room stops, and both Shara and Kathari ask how this is even possible. Thor has forfeited most of the challenges. Shadrach then says yes, Thor did fail miserably in those challenges. She was awarded extra points in the end, though, something that the record keepers of Omnipotent City have never recorded before. Thor inspired other gods to fight in her defense. They crossed the cosmos to wage war in her name. Cole begins to state that that is not the case. We came here because we were humiliated. But Sif tells him to shut it or he shall eat her sword. In a fit of rage, Kathari shouts to Gladiator, telling him to alert the battle cruisers that they are in Earth's orbit and have them fire at once. Gladiator tells them, actually, after all I've seen today, I don't think I can do that. Before Kathari could unleash his holy wrath, Shara stops them, stating that none of them deserve to live in their universe. Now kiss her! Kiss her! And end all creation! As the fires of their love burn, Shara and Kathari call upon the great force in the Shi'ar pantheon, the sister of sorts to the gods. Though once she is summoned, only death and destruction follow. She is called Falcon, the world destroyer, the Phoenix. Jane can feel it just as the hammer does, the feeling that the cosmos itself is burning and she must stop it. As Jane flies out to face the Phoenix, she is knocked back into the palace, and Shara and Kathari laugh at her attempts to save everyone. Just as the laughing gets louder, Gladiator punches Kathari, and Shara turns to him, and just before she can do anything, Kubark flies in, punching her! Both of the two gods are now defeated, and everyone wonders what they do now. There is no way of stopping the Phoenix, and Kubark tells everyone that he wouldn't say that. He knows a guy. Now, back in the current time, everyone rides on Cole's longboat, as Jane asks Quentin if he has any experience with the Phoenix Force. Quentin says, yeah, sort of. Well, in the future I will? I'm kind of destined to wield the power of the Phoenix someday, assuming that that future actually comes to fruition? Cole says, never mind the pink-haired will. The Destroyer will deal with this tiny fire pigeon. And a second later, the destroyer is defeated. Quentin tells Cull, as metal as the destroyer sounds, nothing can destroy the Phoenix because the Phoenix is destruction. Jane grips her hammer, telling them that they shall die trying. And Quentin says, most likely, but hey, at least I'm not bored now. Everyone jumps on the longboat in an effort to try and hurt the Phoenix, but one does not simply hurt something like that. Jane shouts that her hammer blows have no effect. How do they even fight a creature of living fire? Quentin fires his psychic shotgun, telling her, you don't. Even I can't get through to it. The only way we can stop it is to commune with it directly. At that moment, Jane sees the world turning white and her without her hammer. As Jane asks, where is she? The Phoenix tells her, that is a foolish question. But then again, you are one of the most foolish creatures that I have ever encountered. The Phoenix goes on. I have brought you here, in your dying little form, to have a conversation and make you an offer. One to ease you of your many heavy burdens. Well, of one very particularly heavy burden. Jane thinks about it and asks her hammer. The Phoenix wants the hammer. The Phoenix tells her, if you wish to save the other gods from my flames, then all you must do is hand over Mjolnir. Just holding it is killing you, is it not? Allow that burden to be lifted. Jane says, wait. She wants to eat the hammer, doesn't she? Consume the power of the god Tempest, because she is afraid of it. Then it would seem that the Phoenix is wrong about her being a fool. Phoenix punches Jane, shouting that she was trying to help her. She offered her a chance to die with dignity. There shall be not another chance, only suffering. At that moment, the hammer appears in her hand, and Jane swings it, asking, if you want to eat it, you can take a bite. And back outside, the Phoenix screams in pain as Quentin asks how she did it. Then says, you know what? Never mind. Just do whatever that was again. Jane gathers all of Mjolnir's strength, stating that she will not die in her bed. She will die like a god. And while Jane releases the powers of the space hurricane, Quentin's vision changes and he enters the white world. The Phoenix looks at him asking, what do you think you're doing here? It is not time for you yet. You are not ready to be my avatar. Quentin tells her, no, definitely not. Which is why what I'm about to do is going to really piss off a whole bunch of people. And that's just one reason you're going to want to say yes. Outside, Jane continues to struggle with the flames, telling the hammer to hold strong. The Phoenix fears them. The voice then tells her, nay, it is not about the hammer or the axe. It is about Thor. Thor Odinson rides his goat down, telling them that just one Thor was a pain in her fiery hindquarters. Good luck dealing with two. Thor releases a storm, and between the two of them, they begin to tear the Phoenix apart. As the storm begins to take over, Thor notices that there is something else here. Another voice telling him, yeah, you might say that. Quentin appears before them, imbued with the power of the Phoenix, and as the cosmos was saved from total destruction, the Asgardian gods have returned to what they do best, celebrating their victory. However, the celebration was short-lived, as the time for the Congress of Worlds to meet comes. Cull tells Jane that her time is up. He has given her until the end of the week to get rid of her cancer or resign. Volstagg tries to tell Jane that it's okay, but Jane says, actually, Cull's right. Her health has begun to affect her job performance, and her condition is not improving. Though she is resigning, a replacement has already been found, and they will find that she is well prepared for the job. She would like to introduce the Congress of Worlds to Rosalind Solomon, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. Rosalind flies down telling them, sure, she'll be one of their space senators. And as Jane leaves the Congress, she finds Thor Odinson beating on the doors of his mother's chambers. Jane tells him that Odin hasn't allowed anyone inside for weeks, and Odinson shouts that he was not asking for permission! Is she even still alive in there? Jane says that his mother was alive when they last saw her, though it was in a comatose state. Thor then asks, was it truly Loki who stabbed her? But before even allowing Jane to answer, he turns back beating on the door. She stops him, telling him to look. She's got a story of her own that she needs to tell him. Something that she should have told him before. He might want to sit down for this one. And just as the threat of the Phoenix has subsided for now, there is still something else coming. The Mangog. The ultimate judgment. They say once awoken, nothing that lives, nothing that breathes, can hope to stay its wrath. And they are right! And there you have it. The story of Mighty Thor is concluded as it is right now. But coming up soon is going to be the War Thor and the inevitable return of Odin's son. So don't forget to subscribe to this channel. Click the link over here for more Thor videos. Click over here for something recommended by YouTube. And don't forget, I'll see you guys on Twitter at Comicstorian.